Hey team, it's Tim here from High Performance Academy. Welcome to this week's members webinar. So today we're going to be talking all about an introduction to motorsport telemetry. Now, some of you may not have seen much of me around High Performance Academy yet. My name's Tim White. I'm a motorsport engineer by training, and recently I joined High Performance Academy. So before we got started with today's webinar, I just wanted to give you guys maybe a little bit of an introduction to myself and what I've done in the past. So just jump across to my laptop screen here. I'll take you through a couple of images from my career so far. So the vast majority of my career has been working in motorsport engineering. I've worked as a data, strategy, performance and race engineer. I've been lucky enough to work in championships all over the world, including the World Endurance Series, IMSA, British Touring Cars, Blancpain GT Championship, stuff like that. This is a shot of an Audi GT3 car that I currently am a freelance race engineer on, that we actually run here in a local endurance series here in New Zealand. It hasn't always been big, flash, fast race cars racing all over the world. I come from very, very humble beginnings. I originally did my mechanics apprenticeship at a local garage here in New Zealand. While I was at that garage, I got really interested in motor racing. Luckily, the company I worked for, we did quite a lot of racing on the side as well. While I was working for that company, I built my own car, and this is a shot of my first car of my own that I ever built, which is a Toyota Corolla, which we call a DX Corolla, a K70 here in New Zealand. That particular car was powered by a 4AG ZE supercharged 4AG engine. I absolutely engineered everything I could. I did hill climbs, circuit racing, rallies, street sprints, absolutely anything and everything I could get my hands on. I absolutely had a ball doing it. After that, I got to the end of my mechanics apprenticeship. I decided I wanted to do a little bit more. I decided to go to university where I studied mechanical engineering and also stayed on to do a master's in fluid dynamics and mechanical design. After I was finished my studies, I was really lucky to get a job in the United States working for a vehicle dynamics consultancy. So with that company, we consulted to large OEMs and large race teams with lots of resource that were interested in doing simulation work and needed consultant engineers to come and join their team and help them on specific projects. So some of the stuff we would do would be things like tire characterization and modeling, which is what I've got shown up in the top left here. You can see that each one of these dots that's sort of spaced along here, essentially what's going on there is each one of those is a measurement, a force or moment measurement from a tire machine. So we go ahead and test a tire on a virtual racetrack, and then we go and fit a whole lot of mathematical curves to it. Essentially, each one of those curves that's so you sort of see running through the data here like this. Sorry, that's the wrong pointer type. Each one of these curves that you see running through here like this is essentially a mathematical representation. The idea there is that we want to be able to use a virtual model of that tire inside a computer program so we can simulate how the car is going to behave on track. The top right here, this is what we call a yaw moment diagram. This is just a really simple simulation type output. It's a way to visualize stability, balance, metrics as an output of a simulation. So this is where we'll be running a car around a virtual racetrack inside the computer, and we'd be sort of trying different setups and then understand how those different setups impacted on the car's performance envelope. And that's just this yaw moment diagram in the top right here. It's just a tool to be able to visualize that performance envelope. In the bottom here, this is what we'd call a 3D version of a full kinematic model. So you can see we've got all of the control arms in here. So we've got the lower control arm down here, the upper control arm, as well as the uprights. We've got the dampers and everything, a full rocker system in this car. So the idea here is that we can, again, fully simulate the way the car moves around the track and understand how much the suspension is actually moving. While I was in the United States, one of the teams I consulted to was as a data engineer in the IMSA GTLM Championship. So anyone who doesn't know IMSA, essentially it's a really large sports car racing championship. It's certainly one of the major sports car racing championships in the world. This particular car was part of the GTLM class, which is an all-pro class racing what in people in Europe would call a GTE car. The Americans just call it a GTLM. It's essentially a step up from a GT3 car with all pro drivers. I was a data engineer in that particular car, and it was an enormous learning experience, particularly when it came to learning things about the way the Americans tend to do their strategy engineering and everything like that, which I find really, really interesting. This particular shot is a shot of the car that we ran in 2016, which is Ferrari 488 GTLM. This is at the top of the corkscrew at Laguna Seca. I've always really loved this picture because it's a little bit of an unusual perspective of that really famous corner with the car just about to drop right over the edge of that cliff there. So after I left that company, I worked for a motorsport software company where we developed race strategy tools, mostly for endurance racing, but really applied to all sorts of racing. So essentially this is about taking really simple data, which is just timing and scoring data, and then post-processing that into useful visualizations for engineers. So what I've got shown in the top here is, this is like a typical scoreboard, like you would see essentially just the ranking of each car within the race and a few statistics calculated for them there. Got a thing in the middle here, I've got a gap chart. A gap chart is a way to visualize what the gap to your car is relative to your direct competitors, how that's evolving over the race, whether you've been catching in one stint or losing in another, whatever it is. Obviously, this is a track map up here, which is just a good way to be able to visualize where you are on track with respect to your competitors, and particularly in multi-class racing, like you get in endurance racing, where each class in this particular case has a different color associated with it. So you can understand whether you're catching a slower class or whether there's a faster car from a different class that's catching you. Down the bottom left here, this is probably one of the more interesting things involved with race strategy software, is a way to visualize how everybody's strategy has actually played out. So essentially what's going on here, each one of these lines, each one of these colored lines is a single car, and you can see here there's a little block. Hopefully if your screen's big enough you can see this. Each one of these blocks here is a stint, and the gap between each one of those stints is a pit stop. So the idea here is that we can see where each car, when they've made their pit stop, who got in the car, who got out of the car, and then interestingly here at the end as well, we've got some forward predictions based on what that car has done previously in the race to try and visualize how big their fuel windows are going to be further into the race, to understand how everyone else's strategy is going to play out as well as our own. So that was a really interesting learning experience, a lot of opportunities along the way, working in a race strategy capacity and a whole lot of different teams along the way as well. And after that, I worked in the Australian V8 Supercars series as a race engineer. So if anyone that doesn't know Supercars, it's essentially a full space frame class. The cars look a little bit like road cars, but underneath there's really nothing shared with the original road cars. This particular car was based on a Ford Mustang. The class is really fantastic in that there's still quite a lot of technical freedom, or at least at the moment there is, until the regulations change anyway. A lot of technical freedom is suspension geometry, and the people are designing their own anti-roll bars and highly non-linear systems. It's a really, really interesting category to be part of, and something I certainly learned a lot being part of that category. After I left Supercars, I joined Racecraft, and that takes me on to the next thing I wanted to discuss, is that some of you might be aware we've got a sister company called Racecraft. Now, initially, we decided to split Racecraft and High Performance Academy into two separate companies, and the reason for that really was because the subject matters are quite different, in that Racecraft generally focuses more on things like suspension, car setup, data analysis, race driving, whereas High Performance Academy has traditionally focused more on things like engine tuning, engine building, and motorsport wiring. Now, since then, we have decided that there's quite a lot more crossover in our audience than we initially thought. So we've actually made the decision to merge Racecraft into High Performance Academy, which is why you're seeing me here, as I will now be a permanent part of High Performance Academy rather than Racecraft. As a result, all of our courses from Racecraft are going to be transitioned over to High Performance Academy. I'm pretty sure all of them are currently available online on the High Performance Academy website as well. So you'll see more and more of that integration as time goes on, and more of me as well presenting more of the courses. So as we usually do when we go through these members webinars, we usually give you guys a little bit of an update as to what's been happening around the workshop. So I'll run you guys through a couple of the projects we've had going on recently. So you might have seen Andre talking about this in the past. This is our SR20 powered GT86 endurance racing car. I'm sure Andre's brought it up plenty of times in the past, but essentially it's been undergoing another big development push from what we had last season. So last season was all about the main engine conversion, fitting all the new components, a lot of the cooling system was all overhauled and stuff like that. This season, that's really about going through and refining a whole lot of stuff that we originally built into that car. It was a really compressed time schedule when we initially built that car. Initially did the engine conversion to the SR20 from the 1UZ engine that was in it before. But this season has really been about going ahead and refining a whole lot of the stuff, really tidying up a whole lot of details, making things a whole lot nicer, particularly improving things like improving the way we can work on the car, so the serviceability of everything, as well as upgrading a few things as we go. So we're all getting that ready for our local endurance championship, which is starting up here in a few months. So the guys are feverishly working away in the workshop, doing improvements on the car. So this is a shot. I've got a couple of shots here that I just took in the workshop before I came around to the studio to do this webinar. So this is exactly as the car sits right now. So one of the things that one of our mechanics, Brandon, has been working on is building a whole new front bar for the car. So what you see here, essentially in from this area up, this is largely the original Toyota front bumper. And then on the bottom, this is what Brandon has built on the bottom of it. So essentially he just sliced the bar up, and originally also the original bumper has got like some fog light holes and everything that have been built up in here as well to make it all one piece. So the idea here is that we're going to build the front bar exactly like we want it, and then we can take a mold off it and build a whole fiberglass front end. I think we're actually going to mold the headlights and everything into it. It's not something we actually need for the type of endurance racing we do here. So again, just allows us to save a little bit of weight as we go. But a lot of the focus of building this sort of new front bar for the car has been around all of the cooling requirements for the car. So some of you may have seen some stuff that we've done with the cooling and ducting work on this car. So this entry here is the inlet for both the intercooler and the radiator. So both of those heat exchangers are stacked on top of each other. And this is the inlet for both of those. And behind here is a diverging duct that diverges back to both heat exchangers in a shape a little bit like that. So it sort of opens up. It slows down the airflow and you get a bit of pressure recovery inside the duct, which is a pretty important property of something like a proper cooling duct. At the top here, you can see just skipping out here is the outlet of that whole system as well. So the idea here is that after you've gone through the heat exchanger, essentially there's a fully ducted inlet and outlet through both the radiator and the intercooler, and they pop out of this little hole in the bonnet here, which will hopefully be a pretty effective cooling system. So far, it's certainly proved to be pretty effective on track, and we're hoping with this new front bar upgrade as well, where we're able to channel much more of the air through that duct, it'll become even more effective and give us even more safety headroom on the cooling capacity. As well as part of this, we've got these cooling ducts here which are feeding oil coolers in the car. So there's one here and there's a mirror one on this side of the car as well. So on this side here, this is the engine cooling, and on this side, this goes to a transmission oil cooler. And you can see just, it's not really finished what you see in the front bumper here, but essentially this is an outlet for the engine oil cooler, and there's the mirrored thing on the other side of the car. So essentially the airflow comes into the front here, that runs through the oil cooler and is exhausted outside of the bumper through there. And it's quite an elaborate system of ducts. Certainly a lot of time has gone into designing all of that stuff on the car. What's not shown here as well is there's actually a brake, an entry for our brake ducts as well. So that's going to be cut out of the front eventually as well. And that's where we get all of the air to cool our brakes. So that has been a huge undertaking. The guys are, I'd say, most of the way through building the front bar, but we've still got a little bit of work to go until we can actually go and pull the molds off that and start making real parts off it. As well, what's been going on in the background of that car, we've been mounting some damper potentiometers to it. So this is something that's going to be really important, particularly now that we're going to have a whole lot of downforce in this car. So for those who haven't been following the build of this car, essentially we're taking something that's been relatively close to a stock GT86 as far as the body form goes anyway. It's now got a really effective front diffuser, front splitter, also a large rear diffuser, and a really enormous rear wing. Now all of that stuff has been designed as one complete package by Top Stage Composites over in Australia for us, all specifically designed for this car, so it is all designed to go as a matched package. Now, but as part of that, because we're going to have a huge amount of downforce in this car, it becomes even more important to understand what's going on with the suspension position. So we've gone ahead and fitted damper potentiometers to each corner of the car. So what we're looking at here is looking from the front left, at the front left corner of the car. So this is the front left brake caliper just sitting here. You can see the front left strut sitting there. And you can see we've got a little tab welded onto the lower control arm and one onto the body as well. So one of the things you've got to be careful of when you're doing this is to make sure you are obviously staying within travel limits of the sensor. You want to be using as much of the sensor travel as possible. There is a little bit of a compromise with the setup that we've got here. For astute people that maybe have gone through this process of fitting damper potentiometers to their cars, they may sort of realize we've got a bit of an excessive stroke here, and that's true. And that this is mounted inboard on the control arm. Unfortunately, that's just a case of the packaging requirements we've got in this car. It is usually quite a challenge to find a place for a damper potentiometer to fit in there. Certainly behind the wheel, you've got things like the brake ducts, you've got the anti-roll bar connection, the steering rack. It is a pretty busy place. So in front of the center line of the axle is really the only place for it. And the problem comes there where you've got, when you've got actually got the wheel and tire fitted to it, which sits maybe somewhere in here, when you go onto full steering lock, it's actually not a lot of room in there to fit the damper potentiometers at all. Initially, we were thinking about putting them in line with the coils themselves, or sorry, the dampers themselves. In the end, I decided not to do that. It wasn't going to package as well. It wasn't really going to be quite as nice as far as serviceability goes, so I decided to mount them down here instead. So we've also got the same thing on the rear axle as well. So this is looking from the rear of the rear left corner. There's a little post, it's just a bit out of shot here, but essentially it mounts to the lower control arm here, and another tab that you can see just at the top of the body there. So the idea here is that we can log in real time all of the suspension positions. So that's going to be really useful for understanding, or at least approximating, the amount of downforce we've got in the car, because if we know the spring rates, we know how much they've compressed on the straights, then that gives us an understanding of how much downforce we've actually got in the car. The other thing that's really useful for is to understanding things like bump stop engagement, and also, of course, damper tuning as well, to understand where we are as far as on the damper speed histogram and stuff like that. So that's been what looks like a relatively simple job. There is actually quite a lot of work going into figuring out the right positions of all of those, getting them set up on the car. During this week, one of my jobs is going to be going into the workshop and actually calibrating those sensors, mapping the voltage output to the real position output as far as what we're seeing on the damper treble. So I'll be getting into that later this week. As well, our fabricator Jimmy's been going for it. We've been had to modify the rear exhaust section. Now we've got our large diffuser that is removed from the car in this shot. So obviously we're looking from underneath the car, from the rear of the car at the moment. So now we're going to have a central exit exhaust. So you can see where Jimmy's got this new part of the exhaust, which comes on here, and that heads right out the center of the car. Part of the reason for the exhaust exiting out the middle of the car is to be able to gives you a small downforce increase. What I mean by that is we're essentially blowing the exhaust over the back of the diffuser. In fact, maybe I just draw that to make it a little bit clearer. So just jump across to the overhead here. If we're looking from side profile, and this is our diffuser, looking from the back. So let's say back of your wheel, somewhere like here. So what's actually happening is you are taking airflow as it comes underneath the car, and you're diffusing it as it exits out the back here. And one of the problems, I should say, a lot of the downforce is concentrated in this what we'd call the throat of the diffuser in this section here, because this is the area that's closest to the ground. So you've got the highest velocity here, which means you've got the lowest static pressure. So in this area here is really where our downforce is mostly concentrated. But one of the problems you can have when you start to drive the diffuser really aggressively is flow separation at the top of the diffuser. Now, as I said, this whole package has been designed as a package to go together on this particular car. So it's not that we're particularly worried about flow separation, but what you can do to help drive the diffuser even harder and give you a little bit of a help with separation is actually put the exhaust outlet on the same angle as the diffuser. So the idea here is that you've got your exhaust flying out here, that helps to entrain some of the air that would otherwise may be slightly detaching through here, and it can also help to draw even more air out of the diffuser as a result. So the idea here is that we want to take our exhaust outlet and we want to place it roughly on the same angle as on the tangent line here to the exit of the diffuser. So that's what Jimmy's been sorting out in the workshop, has been centralizing that exhaust, and he's actually in the process of building the muffler and exit angle on the car today. The last thing that was going on that happened since the last webinar I did was the mounting for the diffuser. So what you're looking at here is the diffuser leaning up against the bench. So you can see the throat expansion area that I was sort of just drawing before in that diagram. So this is this surface here is the top of the diffuser. And what we've got, the way it works is these pins here, which are mounted to these aluminium plates, they actually lock into some little slots or little holes that are built into the subframe of the car. The idea here is that all we need to do is unbolt the diffuser from the rear of the car, and those pins will slide right out of the back of the subframe. So again, it's just about serviceability, making sure it's really quick to get this thing, well, not just quick, but also easy and accurate to put on and off the car. So we're not having to line things up. You don't have slotted holes, stuff like that. It is really important this stuff goes back on the car in the same place each time. You can see a little bit of detail down here. You can see a couple of holes down there. This is actually where the rear wing stay mounts onto the diffuser as well. So all of that, so it's locked into one system where we've got a wing that locks into the diffuser mounts at the same time. Maybe by the time we get to the next webinar, we'll have a little bit more progress in that, and I'll be able to show you guys exactly what that whole thing looks like. So guys, that's it for the updates in the shop. What we do have going on at the moment is one of our giveaways. So the giveaway that we've got running at the moment is all about engine building. So in this giveaway, we've got a package of tools that'll help you get your engine building right, but also the courses that go along with them as well. So let's have a look what we've got included in the giveaway. We've got a piston ring filer, we've got a rod bolt stretch gauge, a dial bore gauge, and a full set of micrometers. So those are all tools that are going to be really important and really useful if you're going through and doing your own engine rebuilding process. And of course, having the courses to go along with them as well is a huge part of that. Really, it's really going to give you all the pieces you need to go ahead and be comfortable and confident rebuilding an engine of your own. So you guys can go find a link to that either from our Instagram or by heading directly to the hpacademy.com website. As far as recent socials content we've been putting out recently, I went and had a look through YouTube and actually came across this video that came out a week or so ago, which is all about telemetry. This is an interview that Andre did with someone from Motec talking in detail all about the Motec telemetry system. I thought this was a good video to point out today because it relates really closely exactly what we're going to talk about today. As far as motorsport telemetry. So after we go through today's webinar, if you're interested in more checking out more about this, I definitely recommend heading across to the High Performance Academy YouTube channel and searching up this title for race telemetry, and you will find that video, which hopefully will supplement today's webinar well and give you a little bit more information as well. So guys, as always, we've always got more courses coming down the pipeline. As I said, we've recently merged Racecraft into High Performance Academy. So not only have we got more the normal courses coming down the pipeline, but you've also got a whole lot of Racecraft content that's just been absorbed into High Performance Academy. So the courses we've currently got on Racecraft are corner weight. We've got a motorsport corner weighting course, motorsport wheel alignment course. We've got two data analysis courses, one at a more fundamentals entry level, and one what we're calling our motorsport professional motorsport data analysis course, which is a massive resource. We've also just released a race driving fundamentals course. And at the moment, I'm currently in production doing a suspension or motorsport suspension course, which is all about everything from the fundamental theory right through to the practical application of things like choosing spring rates, tuning your dampers, doing lateral load transfer calculations. So if that's the kind of stuff that you guys are interested in, keep an eye out on the High Performance Academy website, because all of that stuff, particularly that suspension course anyway, will be coming on real soon. But you can already find our existing Racecraft content, which has already been transitioned over to High Performance Academy. You'll find that there already. So guys, remember, we've got that giveaway to head across to check it out if you're interested in doing your own engine rebuilding. That set of tools and the courses to go with it are definitely a great resource. So guys, that's the end of the pre-show for the webinar today. I'll be back in a second and we'll get straight into the lesson. If you liked that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you subscribe. We're constantly releasing new videos. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description of this video to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.